Air Force stages its winter air maneuvers, a severe test of men and machines in sub-zero weather. Garbed in their warmest, the Army flyers come from all sections of the country and mount their planes at Selfridge Field, Michigan, to try out the latest developments in equipment for winter flying. Pursuit planes then first. They're going up to battle with Jack Frost in his own territory. When winter comes, warfare does not stop. So the Air Corps means to be ready for business any old time. This is the base on the ground for the squadrons of the air, the GHQ Air Force on the Pacific Coast. Airplanes of the first wing flash across Marchfield, California, while officials on the ground watch the squadrons in action. Then off for a training flight among the clouds, the terrain for fighting tactics of the Air Force. The 34th, 73rd, and 95th attack squadrons dodge in and out to attack or evade the imaginary enemy. A war game of fox and hound. Apparently, the trucks are saved, and all is well. The game's over. And the flyers head for home. The Boeing bomber, the flying fortress. This most modern of warplanes looks like some prehistoric reptile monster as it passes Mount Rainier, mountain giant of the far west. Four motors of 1,000 horsepower each drive wings of a span of 105 feet. 18 tons of fighting force that can be shot through the air at 250 miles an hour, fully loaded with bombs and machine guns for action. 13 of these giants were ordered. First one, then another emerged from the factory in Seattle. Now, a squadron of eight fly together in tactical formation. Interiors of these spectacular giants were kept a secret until after the airplanes had proved themselves in service. For the first time, the cameraman is allowed inside. The gunner spins his machine gun into battle position. Is the United States Army Air Corps ready for its big spring maneuvers? Well, watch this bombing group over Southern California. Hidden from anti-aircraft guns by a natural screen. Now they skirt the clouds as if to prepare for an attack. In another formation, dimly we see the earth below. Having supposedly dropped their bombs, they are up again over the clouds in a perfect line. The 30th and 32nd bombardment squadrons are homeward bound. Look closely, you will see the pilot. The bomber's seat is forward, the observer's aft. One of the most beautiful of formations is a straight line, and it's the hardest to maintain. Thirty-six new two-seated fighting planes, the speediest in the Army, are tried out by the 8th Pursuit Group flying in combat formation in a gunnery test over Langley Field's practice ground. Balloons filled with inflammable gas are targets for tracer bullets fired from machine guns as the fast jets roar and power dive. in the making. American instructors teach Filipino students. How well the flying lessons have been learned, let's see. Let's watch them at work in their area classroom. Hey, don't run over the cameraman. He's needed for the picture. With the Far East ablaze with war and with full independence seen for the future, the problem of the defense of their peaceful shores becomes more significant to the Filipinos. They are determined to have a flying force capable of maintaining their freedom. Fledgling wings are strengthened in Far Eastern skies. The Army receives its latest delivery of twin-motor Douglas airplanes. Hundred of these B-18s were ordered by the Air Corps for long-range bombing missions. The 7th Bombardment Group goes aloft for a trial flight. Formidable engines of battle, testing their new wings against California bombs. Here is the Aracuda, the Air Corps' newest fighting plane, built by the Bell Aircraft Corporation. Test pilots at Wright Field believe it to be one of the fastest, if not the fastest, warplane in the world. It is designed to overtake and destroy the huge, fast new bombers of the Flying Fortress type. Carries a crew of five, about six guns, including two aircraft cannons, and carries a supply of light bombs, making it probably the most powerful fighting plane ever built. Its Fisher-type engines give the forward gunners a free field of fire. With a ceiling of over 30,000 feet, the Aracuda should be well-nigh invincible. Army retires an old veteran of the air after her last flight at the home port in California. Then the work of dismantling begins. The TC-13, known to Army airmen as the Tessie, has flown nearly every other day of her 4 years, 225,000 miles, safely. Huge gas lines run into the stripped airship to withdraw her non-inflammable helium. 360,000 cubic feet of the precious gas is pumped into storage tanks. Germany is said to want part of this huge reserve supply for her Zeppelin. And so the TC-13 passes from the Army's ranks, honorably discharged. Air condition the substratosphere. That's the problem the Army Air Corps has tackled. Normal air pressure for the motors and the sealed cabin is provided by superchargers, driven by the engine exhaust. A crew of highly trained Army scientists will test the specially designed Lockheed C-35, a laboratory on wings. Their testing ground, the little known realm above the highest clouds, where the air thins out toward the emptiness of space. Can air passengers travel in perfect comfort over the top of storms that herald their earthbound brothers? Can aerial warriors climb beyond the reach of anti-aircraft guns or ground observers? That's what the engineers want to know. Their answers will guide future developments in substratosphere flying. So test the new flyer in the highest,